Welcome to Meet the Band. I'm Ben, and this is Daniel, or Danny. And we're here with Alex Hiller on Meet the Band. We're going to talk about Alex's work and his upcoming releases and his band, Seven Roads. First off, let me talk one real quick thing about Alex Hiller. Alex Hiller is a local singer-songwriter who can really arrange for guitar so artfully that his single Spotlight will capture you into these interwoven piece orchestrated guitar with soulful melodies coming from his vocals. So let's kind of dive right into it. Alex, tell me how did you start this song, this inspiration for Spotlight?
Ooh, that's a tough question because it was a long time ago that I started writing it. But I don't know. I think it came along. Actually, it started on electric guitar. I recorded it on acoustic. But I started messing around with that riff on electric guitar, moved capos about the position of the capo has moved about four different times. It took a while to write. That was one of like my longest time spans of being able to write that one. I had that riff forever, that intro and chorus riff. I had that forever, yeah. And I was like, I have no idea, how to bring that, pre-chorus and then bring it back somehow, and anything for a bridge. So those other pieces, it took a while. Those extra little pieces that kind of made it like a full song. I actually have an issue with that. I always write, like, I'll have some, one thing in my mind, and it'll just kind of loop. Like, I have to figure out, how I can, make this so it's a bit more dynamic and not just the same thing over and over again. Because I have zero music theory, actually. Like, everything that I do is just like, does this sound good or no?
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, getting things to match up is always a tricky issue. And talking about dynamics has always been a huge part in getting a song to go from something that sounds like maybe repetitive or mundane. What's the word that you usually like to say?
To monotonous.
Monotonous.
Yep.
Yeah, that always kind of comes up for us when it comes to songwriting. How do you turn a variable on something you already kind of established as like you can just hear how intricate all of these parts are, especially when I get to the last couple outro chorus. Like, you start having like these other like melodic lines up there on that second guitar that just starts bringing it to life for the very last part of the song. There's all these parts everywhere that I kind of love.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Yeah, you're welcome. What about, can you tell us about your lyrical content on Spotlight?
Yeah, so lyrics, kind of having enough confidence to like walk up to that, good looking girl or guy or whatever, having
someone you're attracted to,
trying to take them home.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's straight up. That's what it is. Yeah.
So this is essentially like a rock and roll song.
Yeah, so it's kind of like the most romantic one-night stand ever.
Really? Honestly, there's moments when I felt like, I was like, oh my God, I feel like there's love in the air. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's kind of like being the smoothest scumbag in the room.
No, man, I thought, honestly, when I heard the performance, I honestly thought, we actually listened to it together, so we didn't listen to it by ourselves. And what popped into my mind immediately about the lyrics is that it reminded me, I honestly thought you were talking about someone you were in love with. I felt like it was someone who you really personally, like, either you're reflecting on, like, when you first met this person, or, like, how it's actually going on.
Step into your spotlight, the hook of the song, the chorus, that's like that girl that walks in to the room, and she just, like, she gets everybody's attention, and it's just like, can I step into that and like take you out of it? I didn't have anybody really in mind, and actually it wasn't until I started dating my current girlfriend that I was like, I think I might have kind of wrote that song about you. And I actually said that when we were doing the Brignall songwriters event that I was playing with Danny. I said that because she was there at that show, and I was just like, I kind of wrote this before I knew who it was about, and now I think about her when I play that song.
In your bio, you'd like to talk about how you encourage sing-alongs. I guess that's a notion on how your shows go and how encouraging they can be.
Definitely, I try to get as many people singing and dancing as possible.
Since you usually are a solo act, you use loop pedals.
Yeah, that's my big thing. Actually, like, before before I started doing live shows, it was actually a duo, and I was the backup singer. And then didn't work out right before we had three shows lined up. So I went from being the backup singer that, you know, was going to add in some harmonies to I have to learn. It was a ridiculously long show. It was a 4.5-hour show. It was my first one.
Oh, my God.
So it was like the most trial by fire I've ever been through.
It's like running a marathon.
Well, I can't do this without a loop pedal. So I went and bought a loop pedal, and I was like, I know that I need to be able to lay some rhythm down and solo so I can give myself a break. And
it gives you some flexibility. Yeah,
I ended up getting through it. It worked out really well.
That's awesome.
I was laughing because we experienced very similar dilemma. Like, we went from being a four-piece to being a trio, a power trio. I was laughing just because I could only imagine what was going on in your head, because it takes me back to, like, that first show that we decided to go out as a trio, and, like, basically relearning how to play guitar, how to sing, how to interact with the audience.
Yeah.
Because you go from being able to run around and do whatever to, like,
being stuck at the mic most of the time.
Yeah, you're here. Yep. When you're not singing, you can do your running around, but you're here and you have to engage and you have to banter too. That's the big thing. That's like people, I feel like some people don't really think about that.
Yeah.
Like that, like, hey, I'm gonna have to be able to, like, talk to, you know, the crowd and stuff, and, like, there's certain nights where I'm on with that, and then there's certain nights where I'm just like, I just want to play music, and I'll just go right into the next song. I don't know.
You're from Springfield, right?
Springfield, yep.
Did you grow up in Springfield?
No, I grew up in East Longmeadow. Like, I lived in Munson until about fifth grade. And then moved to East Longmeadow and graduated from East Longmeadow High School, and then went to college, and then now I live in Springfield.
You actually start playing music. How old are you? And, like,
yeah, real young. I started playing guitar when I was real young. I don't know, 9, something like that. I was like, I want to play guitar, you know. So my dad bought me like this little guitar from Toys R Us. It was like this big, and it had a speaker inside of the body of the guitar. I wish I still had that, because that was my, like, true first guitar, and it was just so ridiculous that you could turn on your guitar and have a speaker coming out of the body. Like, I really wish that I still had. I would bring that to work, you know. But I started then, and then I took some lessons. I hated lessons. I didn't have enough interest to be in lessons at that point, so I put it down for a long time. My parents were divorced, and my guitar, this was after, and I had my Ibanez at this point. It's an actual full size guitar that you had to plug into an amp, you know, one of those. And I would go over to my dad's house on the weekends, and we had this dog, this little mini Dachshund at the time, that I was, you know, that was the only thing I did. I was like, I'd go over there and play with the dog, but, you know, the guitar had like an inch coating of dust on it at that point. And then it's very tragic, but I take all of the positive out of this. Dog got hit by a car and killed, and I was, you know, left kind of bored at my dad's house every other weekend. So I picked the guitar up again, and I didn't stop. You know, I just kept going, just kept learning. I had a big metal phase for, like, I don't want to call it a phase, because I still listen to metal and I still get down with metal, but I don't play it as much, you know. Then I kind of started getting back into reggae. Even your original question was how long have I been playing, so I answered that, but I'm gonna continue my rant here.
Yeah,
that's what it's all about. It's now we're
going.
You.
Now we're going through some all genre, right, some genre
great.
Likes, you know.
The metal portion. And the big reggae portion, and the reggae is what brought me back into the chiller side of music, and back to, like, what, you know, I don't write reggae music yet, but I write.
I like that.
You know,
I like that. Yet.
Yeah. No, I need a reggae song, and there's no need to not do that, like, nice, like, you know,
dude,
it's like this beautiful grounding thing, and I don't know, it's like a soulful roots.
You were talking about your love for metal, and then you just jumped to reggae. So my question for you is, are you a 311 fan?
Oh my God, I cannot stand 311.
Oh, I'm not a big 311 fan. That was you, man.
Well, I'm not a
huge. I'm sorry. Oh, yeah, I'm not offending anybody. I enjoy about one song out of their 90 music song catalog.
Sublime, then.
Oh yeah, I like Sublime. Yeah, like money, I'm not a diehard Sublime fan. I'm not gonna call myself a diehard Sublime fan.
Are you into ska?
I know all their radio hits. Yeah, I like some ska.
Do you like the Mighty Mighty Boss Tones?
Yeah.
All right. How about
That's a jam.
How about No Doubt? You like No Doubt?
I never like really listened to her until I saw her do a song with Sublime, and then I was like, oh, she's really cool. And then I like listen to her songs. Like that's like super. It's like reggae ska. Yeah.
Dude,
like,
Gwen Stefani cool. And
I'll look into that a bit more.
That was That was magic. Like, No Doubt was magic. Like straight up magic. There. You cannot like. You know, all the kids like now, and I guess we're young, but the kids.
We're still
all
young,
they know Dan. Is
we're still
all
young.
They
Come
all they
on.
Know is like Gwen Stefani as a solo artist, but like. Dude, No Doubt. Like, you listen to them.
Yeah.
There's no other band that sounded like them on mainstream.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep. Yeah, she was cool. She was, like, just a really, like, punky, lot of attitude when she performed and just all over the place. It was cool. Definitely cool.
What kind of band is Seven Roads? Talk to us about Seven Roads.
All right, dude. So we're just, like, the best way to describe us is we're a party band. So we just play, like, this, like, all, like, the hit, you know, the
sounds
hit
like
songs that people are gonna sing and dance
sounds
to,
like rock.
That's
sounds like
for
a fun
covers,
show.
That's
like
that's
us.
Where we're at, right?
Yeah.
So our originals so far, we have one written. I brought that one to the table. That was one that was kicking around for a while, but really required a voice of someone like Ryan Harrington, the our lead singer, or somebody like Danny. You know,
mm-hmm.
It wasn't I didn't write that song for my voice, so I rarely played it acoustic. That song's called Harder on the Weekends, and it's basically talks about like it was actually the phrase was coined by my buddy Devin out in Munson, who's like a really hard working kid, but like will party the entire week and then he goes harder on the weekends. So his thing was like he's always just like, dude, we go hard on the weeks and harder on the weekends, man. You know, like that's
line?
His like
love
style
that.
And attitude. So I was like, all right, I'm gonna write a song about it. And I wrote that one when I was on vacation in Florida. I was actually at my Nana's house just with an acoustic guitar. And it was just like, beginnings like standing knee deep in clear water, lit up from the sunshine's rays. Yeah. And it's just like, I wrote it out in Florida with like a vacation kind of party. What's up?
I'm excited. And I want to hear you play this song. We're going to go pretty much Howard Stern right now, and I want you to play me your best version of this song, acoustic.
Oh,
you're
God.
On the damn
That's
spot.
That's awful.
You right now. You're on the spot.
Ouch. All right. Hold on a second. So, you're already making it challenging.
Oh, more
like
importantly, by the way, as flattered as I am, as you're telling me, you know, it's a song I wrote for my singer or a guy like Danny, I gotta interject. You have a really beautiful voice, by the way. So like,
oh, thank you.
So you can, you know, in better terms, if I was gonna be, if I didn't have to keep it rated G, I would tell you to go F yourself.
For how good it sounds.
That's how good you sound. So just do your best and just let's hear it, man.
That's a classic. Yeah, Brian right. Compliment.
Oof,
he's like,
right.
I'll punch you in the face. That's what
tough.
Brian Shaquin would say. Father Brian would say.
Alright, so I don't even sing this song anymore, so if I can nail these lyrics, that'd be awesome, but I might blow my voice out doing this, because I'm going to try to do it in like the
Just
in
take
the
us off. Be,
it.
Be super acoustic, like atmospheric about it, you know
mm-hmm.
what I mean? Just be chill.
Oh, that's weird. The Hendrix, you know? Not going up for tomorrow, but all we have is today. So standing knee deep in clear water, lit up from sunshine's rays. I'm alive and breathing, gasping for air. Cause I don't have it all, but I have some advice to share. Tomorrow's not a guarantee, so go on singing loud with me. Singing loud with me. We're going hard on the weekdays, harder on the weekends. Feeling so good and I don't want this to end. Because we're going hard on the weekdays, harder on the weekends. So good and I don't want this to end. Another verse, another chorus, and then we bridge, and then we solo after that.
Yes.
Dude, so solo. So I heard.
Put,
not only did I hear Hendrix, right, but I heard Black Crowes in your song. I heard the Spin Doctors, like the early like 90s parties bands that were like left over that nobody remembers. Like that's what it brought me back to. That song,
hell
like
yeah.
that's awesome.
Hit.
We're working on we're early in the recording process of that, but it was just like I was just super stoked about it, and like you know that was that repetitious thing, and when I first brought it to the guys, they're like, you know, it's great, but like it needs something. So like me and Ryan got together with acoustics and figured out like, all right, we'll just throw this like pre-chorus thing in, so that gives it enough of that, like, you know, brings it back, and that whole verse and the chorus are the same. You know, the same chord progression, but during the verse, like it's all, I do it clean and I do like those riffy Hendrix type things. And then for the chorus, hit the distortion and boom, hard on the weekdays and harder on the weekends. And that's where like Ryan, like just blows his voice way up in his range and like power. And, that's, you know, that's where it's meant to be. And then the solo that I play in that song is definitely my favorite song to solo to. It's just fun, and I tear it up on that. There's songs where it's like, all right, you know, I have like some space to like do, you know, like, you know, we play Last Dance, you know, Tom Petty's Last Dance with Mary Jane there, and like, you know, I can do some, you know, I have enough like space and like freedom to rip whatever I want there. But it's not until like it's your own song and you still have that space to do it that really like ignites your like lead guitar player vibe. And I've always been a lead guitar player. That's, you know, so it was, you know, that the whole loop pedal thing's always been a necessity, because I wouldn't like be honest if I just went out and just sang songs for 3 hours. It just wouldn't be as authentic as just me going out there and adding some solo. And I play harmonica too, so.
Oh, dude, you're mean at harmonica.
Nasty.
Like I'm practicing. That was actually pretty. That came around pretty quick. Like I picked up a harmonica, from my dad. Like my dad plays harmonica or a little bit. He dabbles. He used to play really well, but now he's got the confidence barrier that stops him from playing. But he's good, man. Like, you know, Whamma Jamma. Jay Giles' harmonica song.
Jay Giles. I know Jay Giles. I don't know if I know that song in particular.
After this, go check that out. And like, he used to play at Note for Note. You know what I mean? So
really,
I'm trying to get him back on that. But anyways, I was like, I commandeered a couple of his harmonicas because he wasn't using them, and I just started like messing around, and like within a month, I was like, this is. For like a month or a couple of weeks, I'm like, this is enough to bring this live, you know. So I just started buying a bunch of harmonicas, and that came along pretty quickly. But recently, I've been like, all right, like, stop with this. Like, I play harmonica good enough that I can bring it out live and actually sit down and put a backing track on, or listen to, like, I was listening to Grateful Dead today. And back in like the early 70s when they had a Pigpen and he played harmonica, and I was just like trying to just mimic the, you know, his stuff. And like, I want to take harmonica to the next level, but I do use the harmonica quite a bit, and people actually respond really well to harmonica. I was surprised with that.
You know, when you're a badass harmonica player, is when you start playing chromatic harmonica.
Like, oh, is that those ones that are
like
this big?
What's his name? Oh my God. Run Around, singer of
Blues Traveler.
Yeah, what's his name? James.
Yeah.
I don't know. Oh God, I don't know. But that band is freaking awesome, man.
That guy is a virtuoso of. That guy is a virtuoso of harmonica. I don't think there's a better player of the harmonica than that dude.
He shreds like metal, dude.
We talked about you as a solo artist, and then you talked about joining a band.
Yep.
But what's that like? Like you write songs. You brought a song to your band.
So everyone's situations are going to be different, right? When they go into a writing situation with a full band, sometimes it might be challenging, and sometimes it might be really, really inspiring because the musicians come up with their parts kind of on their own sometimes. Or sometimes you're like, what you're playing needs to be fixed. How does that? How have you gone through that? How has that been, basically?
Yeah. Do you find it easy? Do you find it difficult at times?
Like, no, it's challenging. So I mean, we were in this thing where we had to learn covers like crazy. Excuse me, just so we could get shows. Like we weren't gonna write 3 hours worth of originals before we learned 3 hours of covers. So like it was covers first, and it took a while for us to learn originals, right? So, yeah.
Who would have three hours of original music?
What was that?
I said who would have 3 hours of original music, but like it's because of a lifespan of like 20 years of writing music.
Right. Yeah. I mean, exactly. You need Van Halen and three stuff albums to get anywhere close. Yeah. So yeah. So you gotta learn some covers, right?
Go watch a Grateful Dead.
So we were learning the covers, and then as far as like the challengingness of it, it was challenging. I brought that song to them, and they were like, "Yeah, it sounds great. I think it needs something." And I was just like, "Really? Does it need something?" And I didn't take that criticism well. Like, it was, of course, it needs something, dude. But it's the same three chords the entire song. Throw something else in there, right? So I took
layering, and then
I was like, "All right, it needs something." So then me and Ryan sat down with acoustics, got through it. Add some new stuff, and then we came in. We're like, hey, Ryan's got the melody down. He mixed up the melody a little bit, but still carries the same tune for the chorus. That went really well. Some people watched it and they're like, damn, like that's good. Like, and other, we got like Brian's roommates his roommate Jack was like, dude, I was up in my room the other day and I was going harder on the weekends, and we're like, yes, so like that's awesome. That feeling's great. So we got other songs in the works right now. Two that Ryan has started. Those are really cool. They're not as like bluesy, and they are rocky. They're rock, but it's more like he has big like Kings of Leon and Oasis inspiration. Yeah. Okay. So there's a bit more of that dynamic in his songs. And then we have two others. One that our bass player started writing, and that was like just like super like wicked punky. And we're all like, all right, we're not really a punk band, so we love your like. Your chorus and your idea, but we're gonna have to bring that back to like Seven Roads,
Right.
And then the other one was a riff that I started that I'll show you. And this one's fun. This one's like wicked, like dirty guitar, and like the drums come in like hard. So this one's like. It's just like that, and then it comes in, it's just that kind of like Black Keys kind of hard blues vibe.
Yes.
Gary Clark Jr. type stuff,
I
so
love that.
That one I'm really excited about. That one I'm excited about all of our original music. It's fun, and it was needed. Me and Ryan were like we need originals, and took us a little bit to get there, but it was true that we needed a bunch of covers to back that up. But
right,
it just got our covers in place.
It facilitates
now we can like slowly
gigs.
Learn covers and write music, and
right,
that's where I want to be.
Yeah, it facilitates getting gigs. what it is.
Yeah, that's
everyone's gonna write their music, write stuff, art. It's happening. Yeah. It's coming out of the woodworks, because we're all forced to do it. What else are we gonna do with our time? We're like, all right. I have 12. I have 12 extra hours of practicing my guitar. Okay. All right. Yeah. Let's put that to work.
So.
Yeah.
Before we wrap this up. Is there anything that you'd like to kind of touch upon, Ben, like concerning his original songs that we listened to? Like,
Well, I'd say like listen to Spotlight, fall in love with it, because I know that that's what it's designed for. Fall in love in the spotlight. and definitely, I think a lot of people are going to be really happy with how those guitars just like really reach through their. The hairs on their back of their arms and stuff.
Dude, that's just gonna. I sent you a message the night I listened to it, and I said, "Dude, I'm in love with your guitar playing."
It's just, it's too nice. It's too nice.
It reminded me of John Mayer.
Yeah.
Which is funny because then you started playing John Mayer earlier, and I was like, there it is.
I'm a huge John Mayer fan, and we have a love hate relationship because one, I hate him because his fingers are like this long, and I have little sausage hands. I don't know if you guys knew this about me, but my fingers are like infant fingers, and
let's do comparisons. Here, put it up. Yeah. Here. So, I guess, Seven Roads. We got new releases, Spotlight, Harder on the Weekends. How should we end this out? What else is left? Yeah, I guess what your next steps are?
Yeah, my next steps actually like so. I'm trying to take like with the band, kind of want to focus on writing originals and stuff, and then with myself, I need to record an album like as soon as possible. Not even an album, just an EP, 4 to 6 songs, right? And not just acoustic. So Spotlight is just acoustic. Like 4 different tracks, a guitar, a couple harmonies, but I need a band on my stuff. I need to get electric and harmonica in there and all that. So that's the that is like the next step with that. And additionally, I'm trying to make the myself as more of a business too. Like I need a website. So I started looking up and I was asking around a bunch. What do you guys use for websites and seems like I might either be using Wix or Bandzoogle, is it?
Yeah, do you remember like the time like when you had a MySpace? Anybody remember when you had MySpace?
I wish I still had a MySpace. Really? Yeah, I had a MySpace.
No, well, the reason why I bring that up is because Bandzoogle is kind of like that. It's kind of like that. When you had a MySpace, you could input code to change like the layout of your MySpace.
That's true. Yeah. It's true. Customizable.
It's so easy to use Bandzoogle. It's
use HTML.
It's so stupidly easy to like design a website. It's like click and drop.
I guess an hour later, we've really kind of delved into the mind of Alex Hiller here.
And within an hour of it, yeah. I appreciate you guys having me. It's a really great opportunity to just talk to a couple musicians and get this out there and.
Yeah,
have an hour of good dialogue about some of my inspirations and different paths and stuff that I want to take.
We're going.
Thank you guys very much for the opportunity. You're welcome. Appreciate
it. Thank you for coming, man. Thank you for giving your time. And it's a special quarantine episode.
Yep, special quarantine episode.
And
there is a good thing to talk about at the last moment here is. That because of all this, we might be finding that it might be not as soon as we think when it comes to performing in front of the locals, the people. So the more that we continue to invest our time in learning how to use this technology all around us, to use this to
to
be able to continue creating our art is essential to how we're gonna all thrive. And continue to survive.
Yep.
Because
that's two other things I'd like to add before we log off is that I'm not, it's not every week because I do take some weeks off, but I've been doing a thing called Tuesday Night Tune In. I have myself and two other artists on. Dan's been on it with Nick Dent. That was me being sandwiched in between two powerhouse vocalists right there. But I'm so okay with it. Like I'm so happy that I can like share platforms and like stages with people that are way better than me, because that means that I'm good enough to play with these people, right?
I'm really humbled that you say that.
You know, that's awesome. What was that?
I said I'm really humbled that you say that, because I work really hard doing what I do, but more importantly, I'm humbled because I really, really, I'm inspired by you, just so you know. Like, aww. I think you're a great singer-songwriter, and I think very highly of you. So, you know, like, you know.
Thank you, man.
From what little
that.
I have seen and little I've experienced and the shows that we've played, I've definitely gone back and I'd be like, fuck, I gotta keep working. I gotta, like.
The talent is there. The talent is the. I guess we could wrap things up. So, yeah. Thank you, Alex Hiller. Thank you, everyone, for watching. This is another episode of Meet the Band with Alex Hiller. My name is Ben. And this is Danny from Arc City Angels. We'll be continuing to supply some more content. Make sure you like this video and subscribe to our channel. And then also check out Alex Hiller's. You'll see it in the description.